ಹಲೋ, ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಈ ಪಯಣ ನಾವು ಹೊರಟಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಸೋಮನಾಥಪುರ ಟೆಂಪಲ್ ಹಾಗೂ ತಲಕಾಡು. ಈ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿರಲ್ಲ, ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ನಲ್ಲಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಯಾಕಂದರೆ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕಡಿಮೆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿರೋರೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ತಲಕಾಡು ಸೋಮನಾಥಪುರ ಗೊತ್ತೇ ಇದೆ. ಸೊ ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಹೊರ ರಾಜ್ಯದಿಂದ ಬಂದವ್ರಿಗೆ ಈ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಉಪಯೋಗ ಆಗಲಿ ಅನ್ನೋ ಕಾರಣಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಈ ವಿಡಿಯೋನ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ಎಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಧ್ಯನೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲೂ ಸಹ ನಾನು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಸೊ ದಿ ವೆದರ್ ಇಸ್ ಪ್ಲೆಸೆಂಟ್, ನೀದರ್ ಟೂ ಹಾಟ್ ನಾರ್ ಟೂ ಕೋಲ್ಡ್. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್. ಅಪ್ರಾಕ್ಸಿಮೇಟ್ಲಿ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 9:30 ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ವಿ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು. ಅರೌಂಡ್ 130 ಕಿಲೋಮೀಟರ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೋರ್ ಯು ವುಡ್ ರೀಚ್ ಸೋಮನಾಥಪುರ. ಬಟ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ವೇ, if you're not having breakfast, because we decided to have breakfast and we carried lunch, everything with us, so we didn't really stop anywhere. But this is the first city, or I would say a district that you would come across, Ramnagara. But then as we head on, we would reach Channapatna. Channapatna is called the land of toys. So if you want to buy any good wooden toys, you can do a small pit stop here to buy toys at Channapatna. Then the next stop would be in Madur. Madur is very famous for Madur Vada. So if you've not had your breakfast, of course you can have breakfast in Madur and take a left towards Somnathpura. Entire journey would be around 3.5 to 4 hours depending on the traffic. But since this was at the time of coronavirus, we could hardly find traffic on Mysore Bangalore road. Otherwise there would be huge traffic on the Mysore Bangalore state highway. But this road, after we take deviation from Madur towards Somnathpura, is a beautiful, beautiful land that you see with paddy fields. And do you see that ragi fields there? I'll just show you now. Complete rustic village view, and those are ragi crops that you just saw on the right hand side. That one there, that's a ragi crop. So you see lot of paddy, sugarcane and ragi fields around where the farmers were working. And after almost 1.5 hours, close to 1.5 hours, we reached Somnathpura. And from there we went inside. This time the tickets were not issued in cash. We had to make Paytm payments and pay the entrance fees, and then we entered the temple. This is how it looks from the front, and that's where we actually came from. And there is a beautiful lawn outside the main structure. This is how it looks, the big Garuda Stambha there. And then we have a small, note in the site, which is of the Archaeological Survey of India. They have given the background to this temple, which you can see. It's good to read this before you enter the temple. There are no deities that are worshipped here, because the original the murti that we say, the Keshava murti, the original murti is said to have been taken away by the British. So you don't get to see any deities, and hence it is not worshipped. So as we enter, we see this wooden door and these beautiful, really well carved pillars which are in circular shape. And that's the main temple that you see. But before we enter the temple, we'll see what is there, in this entrance corridor where I'm actually standing and taking this video. The left hand side of this particular corridor, as soon as you enter, you see this huge inscription which is written, which is carved basically. In, I guess, I don't know what it is, but I guess it is either Sanskrit or old Kannada, that is Halegannada. I couldn't make out because some of it had actually been erased. Isn't it so wonderful to find such marvelous, things? And then on the right hand side, again, you have a small note about the temple. Do read them. And then in these corridors are kept, some of these sculptures have been kept, which I think are undone. I guess so, I'm not sure. And then there are huge corridors on either side of the temple. We'll see that later. But first, this beautiful Keshava temple. It looks beautiful from outside, so let's explore from inside. You see those domes? They are beautiful. I mean, it was pretty dark inside, so the video, I just couldn't, capture the real beauty of it on my mobile. But I should honestly tell you, this is a worth visit place. If you're looking for a place, to go out on a day trip, then this is the one you should be, really heading to. These are beautifully carved sculptures. And there are three deities here, basically the Krishna, Janardana and Keshava. What you saw just now was Krishna. And the best part, or something that is very unique about this temple, is also that the person who carved these sculptures, their names have been been written. They have carved the names of these people just below the murti. Isn't that a wonderful thing? I don't think you would get to see any such thing anywhere else, but this is the beauty of the Somnathpura temple. And you just see the detailing here, the detailing, the carvings. I mean, these are something that blow my mind each time I go visit such places. It was a similar experience when I went to Badami, Ajanta, Ellora, Pattadkallu, all these places with these beautiful, beautiful stone carvings are something that I really don't understand how they used to do it, especially on the ceiling. I mean, is with no modern technology, how did they really do this? Amazing. And this one is the Janardana deity, and the first one that you saw was the Krishna. And now this is the main deity. This is called the Channakeshava Murti. This is what is being called as the Keshava Murti, or the Keshava God Keshava. And this is where they say the original deity was actually replaced by this one. The original, I've heard, read somewhere, it was taken away by the British during the British rule. But whatever said and done, the entire temple is worth a visit, I'll tell you guys. If you cannot make to Belur Halebidu, which is just as good as this, or even better, I should say, in terms of its vastness, it's much more huge. But the Hoysala influence has continued. This place was earlier ruled by the Cholas and then was taken over by the Hoysalas. And this is a typical Hoysaleshwar temple. This is how it's very similar to Belur Halebidu as well. Belur Halebidu is around five hours journey. It's a little far from Bengaluru to cover up in a single day. But this is something that would make good for that. Well, of course, Belur Halebidu is much bigger in size and even more beautiful than this one is. But just imagine, if this is so beautiful, then what about Belur Halebidu? aren't these sculptures the, I mean, just look at the detailing, even the, you know, the minutest details have been, you know, taken care of, I should say. How so perfect? I mean, look at the corners, look at each of these corners here and those, you know, the top part of the shrine. I mean, how can somebody carve it to so much of perfection? And if you see here, there are two elephants here and there are many more around. It is believed that this had also, you know, there's a way in which they made these carvings, or you know, the way they constructed the temple. The elephants are at the base of the temple, and it is said it is so because it is an indication that the elephants are carrying the burden of the Lord and the temple on their shoulders. And on top of that, exactly on top of that, you see horses on which the kings are riding. It means that this was built by the kings themselves. And then on top of all that comes all these murtis and god and goddesses, and you know, a lot of stories about mythology are also carved on these stone walls. So the idea behind all this is very unique. And if you see here, you know, it is not circular or round, it is triangular shaped. Every you know, alternative place you see it is in a triangular or like a star shaped. Probably if you see from above, it would look very pretty, I guess. I'm not sure how it looks from on top, but if you probably see from a helicopter, I think it should look like a star below. And these are the corridors from where you see the temple. And there are no murtis kept here. They are just plain corridors. Not sure what it was used for, but they are beautifully built. But all good things come to an end. So saying a goodbye to this beautiful Somnathpura temple. Let's hope to visit here sometime soon. But for now, let's head straight to Talakadu from here. Bye bye Somnathpura temple. Before leaving for Talakadu, my attention, you know, just struck on one of the shops here, which was a brass shop, and this person showed a Himalayan ohm. He told us was this vibration and the sound that it makes when you try to rotate it in a certain way with that wooden stick increases the positivity in the home. Well, my husband gave it a try as we all watched. My parents were with me and my daughter was also with me. So the road to Talakadu was even better, I should say, with green fields on one side, and on the right hand side we could see River Kaveri flowing in its full glory. Talakadina story ellarigu gottu anta bhavistini, but for the ones who don't know, they say Talakadu was once a very prosperous and a very fertile land because it was on the banks of River Kaveri. But due to a curse given by Queen Alamelamma, it is said to have covered in sand. Well, I'll give a brief to the story. It is believed that, you know, the Wadiyar Rajas during that time, he ordered his servants to chase Queen Alamelamma and take away all her jewelries. And during that time, before falling into River Kaveri, she cursed the king by saying, Talakadu Maralagali, that means let Talakadu turn into a sand dunes, let it be covered in the sand dunes. Malangi Maduwagli means let river Malangi turn to a whirlpool. Mysuru Arasarige Makkalagadirali means let the Maharajas of Mysore fail to beget Hais, that is children. Okay, so after parking our vehicle near the Kalyani here, we head straight to the Vaidyanatheshwar temple. And all the temples here are believed to be worshipped by the Vaidyas themselves. But this temple is very important in history because this is where it is said that even Alame Lamma's husband had made his last visit. And this is how the temple looks from outside. Of course, inside the photography was not allowed. And here you see, the beautiful corridors, and there was a Ganesh Murti here. And then we came across these five lingas, and hence probably it has got the name of Panchalingeshwar temple. It is believed that Talakadu had nearly 30 temples around, but today we hardly find 5 to 6 temples, and most of them are covered under sand, and it's all buried and you can't find them today. Years back, it is said that all these temples were completely covered with sand, but over the period of time, the government they've taken the initiative of ensuring that these temples are not covered by sand, and hence a lot of sand has been removed, and I think it's been sent to different places. And today you don't get to see sand in that huge quantity, probably which was there around 400 years back, at around 16th century when the curse and all this took place. And since then, the Rajas of Mysore, the Vadiyar family, have been going through a lot of problems, and we should say the curse has worked in some way or the other, because here in Talakadu, even today, you find a large part of it, though not in sand, but still the temples that are that are buried and you don't find them are still under the sand. So that's one thing. And the kings also couldn't have children after a certain generation. And you see that the ring there, the stone rings, they're actually not kept one inside another, but it's carved in such a way that it looks like a ring. That's beautiful. One advantage of coming to these places during the corona time was the less crowd. I would say if you're planning to go to such places which usually are very crowded, I think you should make up to these places as soon as possible. If you can see, there's hardly any crowd. So if you're a bit careful, of course, social distancing, wearing mask, if you do all that and take proper precautionary measures by using sanitizers, and we had carried some extra water also with us, because we had carried food also with us. So we never had food anywhere outside, including the tea and coffee and the milk of my daughter. Everything we carried with us. And here we enter the actual sand dunes, and here you see the board which says that there are three main temples on the way here. It was a wonderful path here, though it was a little long. But due to less crowd, we had the comfort of, walking on our own the way we wanted to. But yes, you should take care of the elderly people along with you. I prefer you all wear shoes like this because it makes your, the walking more comfortable. This is around 2.5-3 kilometers of walk. So be prepared for it. My daughter completely enjoyed, and she played here all along the way, And here we come to the first temple, the Pataleshwar Swami Temple. Do you all see that the level of land today and the level of land that was before the curse? So there are a lot of temples that are there. Probably you never know, they might be there even on the path where you're actually walking. But I guess it was hard for them to excavate. And I made this courage to capture the murti for you. And the priest did not notice it. I guess I was a bit lucky. Okay, then we head back. And again, walking in the sand, having some fun there on the way. As we reach the next temple, that is the Marleshwar Swami Temple. And yeah, as we walk along, we see a lot of trees around, and most of them are eucalyptus tree that you see. And you see those temples there, that is the Kirti Narayana Temple there. But look at the height with which we are seeing the temple. We are walking here, but we are seeing the temple in a place which was earlier, you know, it was covered in sand. And today the level of this temple is so different from the level at which we are seeing them. Just imagine how much of sand must have been removed to make the temple accessible for people. It's amazing, really amazing. And so we reach the Marleshwar Swami Temple, and here I lit two diyas because the period at which we visited this temple was very recently, a week back. So the Kartik Masa is going on, so I lit a couple of diyas here along with my daughter and mother, and we worshipped here, and we left for the next temple, which was Chaudeshwari Devi Temple. It was around 4:45, and we were walking along, and I noticed that these trees, how do they grow in sand? I don't know, it should be a miracle. Such huge old trees that are still standing tall. It's actually wonderful, an experience. So here we reach the goddess Chaudeshwari temple, where we worshipped. And we reached the Kirti Narayani temple from there. And my daughter was very excited to see the sand dunes where a few children were playing, and so she also wanted to play. But we first visited the temple, and then she was given her time to play here for some time. And so this is the entrance of the Kirti Narayani temple. Again, photography was not allowed inside the temple, so I've taken a small I've shown you from the exteriors of the temple here how it looks. So as we enter, we worship there inside again, and we took the blessing of the god, and we came out from there, and I captured the beauty of this beautiful temple from outside. The moon had come out, and the entire view from here, from this platform in front of the temple, was very beautiful. And there was a tulsi here, and we went in circles for three rounds around the tulsi. And since it was just 2 days after the tulsi puja, so it was really it was looking really nice, because they had put these rangolis here, and they had worshipped the goddess. So yeah, and then it was time for my daughter to play. Now it was time for us to leave. We had tea and some snacks which she had carried with us before saying goodbye to Talakadu. It was a very short and sweet trip. You too should come here sometime soon. If you're planning a trip here, a day trip here, then a few details on the same, a brief on how you can make it up to this place, and everything will be provided in the description box, so do check out for it. And people, if you've liked this video, give it a big thumbs up, share, like, comment and subscribe to my channel for more such videos. Thank you so much for watching. See you all soon in my next video. Until then, bye bye and take care.